Single subject designs, or you could call them single case designs, are a kind of quantitative research that involves studying in detail the behavior of each of a small number of participants. And you could see already that this is a little bit unlike what you might have expected. Even if we're doing something called a single subject design, we might actually be looking at a large number of people. It's just by calling it a single subject design or a single case design, what we mean is we're not comparing these people to each other. We're just looking at each individual by themselves. So single subject design or single case design, it can be experimental or non-experimental. And as you might expect, for it to qualify to be a true experimental design, you have to manipulate something and you have to control other things, right? Like you have to have an independent variable and a dependent variable, and you need to try to control those extraneous variables as best as you can. So let me just give you an example. Researchers from the beginning of psychology have been studying rats, and we use rats to, you know, make discoveries about learning and memory and how those work. In these kinds of studies, researchers will periodically measure their participant rats' behavior and try to identify trends. So if you look at this chart on the right, this is a individual rat's frequency of behavior over 6 observations, and they might notice over these observations that the rat's behavior is increasing. The frequency of that behavior is increasing. What exactly this means? Well, it's up to the researcher to make that kind of determination, but the point is we're looking at this individual and charting their progress over time. That's the basic idea behind a single subject design. But there's different kinds of single subject designs. And one of the more famous kinds is called a case study. So this is a detailed description of an individual, which can include both qualitative and quantitative analyses. So with a case study, what we usually are doing is we're just trying to learn as much as we can about some individual. Perhaps something interesting happened to them, or perhaps they were born in an interesting circumstance. Like, we just want to learn about this individual and what's going on with them. And case studies can help us to do things like suggest new research questions, illustrate general principles, understand rare phenomena, like I was describing earlier. You know, sometimes we just find an individual that's just different in some way, and we want to understand how being different like this is, you know, affecting them. And there are numerous case studies that are quite famous in psychology. I'm sure you've heard of some of these, and I would like to just mention a few of them. So first of all, you have the case of Anna O, a famous case study done by Sigmund Freud. And Freud took extensive notes on Anna O. Now, you see, Anna would avoid water as much as she could. She, for example, she would take up a glass of water that she was very thirsty for, but as soon as it touched her lips, she would push it away like someone suffering from hydrophobia. She sustained herself on fruit, melons, etc. to lessen this thirst that she clearly was suffering from. Freud eventually discovered that she had witnessed her lady's little dog drinking from a glass and was unable to counteract the effects of this repressed memory. Sounds kind of silly nowadays, but this is made quite a big deal back in the day. This was super interesting, and it helped to illustrate basic principles like repressed memories and trauma and things like that. Nowadays, people wouldn't be freaked out by dogs drinking out of their cups unless, you know, some kind of weird circumstance. I think you get the point. But a much more interesting, in my opinion, case study is that of Phineas Gage. So, if you've ever taken a Psych 101 class, I'm sure you've heard of Phineas Gage. He was this railroad worker who survived massive brain damage. what actually happened is while he's working on the road, he was putting in blasting powder to try to, you know, destroy like a hole in a mountain or something. I don't remember the details, but the point is he's smashing this blasting powder with this rod you see him holding in the picture, and he didn't do it properly, and the blasting powder ignited, and the rod went through his face. It went into his eye, like right about here, like in the orbit of the eyeball. Or no, actually it went in right about here. Yeah, that's right. It went in about here, and it came out the top of his head. So the interesting thing about the story is that he survived, and he actually survived for quite a long time. He didn't seem to be much injured by this massive, you know, brain damage. But there was one big difference between Phineas Gage before and after he was affected, and that was his personality. So, in other words, he went from being a responsible, mature adult to an emotional child who would have these temperamental outbursts from time to time. And researchers looking at Phineas Gage, they made the connection between the kind of brain damage he suffered, which was in the frontal lobe, and the ability to have these more mature, adult-like behaviors and thoughts. So this was one of the first like pieces of insight we had into the functioning of our frontal lobe, how important it is to control ourselves and restrain ourselves and think about like cause and effect and things like that. Now, single subject design can be a great way to look at interesting circumstances and come up with, you know, broad ideas about how things might work. The goal of single subject design is to try to just find some basic kind of cause-effect relationship between variables. So it can definitely be like an experimental kind of design, but it's generally a bit more exploratory, a bit more broad in nature. And the general methodology of a single subject design tends to combine a lot of elements of this kind of case study we were talking about and, you know, a series of measurements over time, so like a time series design. So just the basic idea here is that we're just looking at one individual and tracking their progress over time. Taking highly detailed notes of a single individual and measuring that individual, you know, before and after something interesting happens, most likely. Now, if you're going to do a single subject design, you're going to have to abide by a few basic assumptions. Number one, it's important to focus intensively on the behavior of individual participants. That seems pretty self-explanatory. If you're doing a single subject design, then you should look at single individuals. But the whole idea here is we don't want to compare people. We don't want to see like how one group can be different from another group. What we're looking at is what's interesting about this individual person or individual people. So no comparison will be made between individuals. The second big assumption is that it is important to discover causal relationships through the manipulation of an independent variable and careful measurement of a dependent variable and the control of extraneous variables. So that's pretty obvious. If you're going to be doing any kind of cause-effect kind of analysis, you have to do the basics of experimental design. You have to have that manipulation and control. And then the third assumption is that it's important to study strong and consistent effects that have like a biological or social importance. Now, this goes back to something I was talking about earlier, having to do with the law of large numbers, sample size effect, you could call it. The whole idea here is, if you want to find like a small effect, you need a very large sample. So if you're going to have a very small sample, then you would obviously need to look for very large effects. To put it more simply, there's a trade-off. The more people you have, the more power you have, the easier it is to find effects, even if they're very small. But if you only have a single person, it's going to be really hard to find anything unless it's a very powerful effect. So, single subject research can be pretty useful, but obviously not everybody does it. You probably haven't even really heard about it. This is not the kind of stuff that tends to get published in most scientific research article, like journal articles. But single subject research has been used since the beginning of psychology and is still being used. Think back to, like, the father of psychological science, Wilhelm Wundt. He was doing single subject research back when he first got started. So this stuff has been done since the 1800s. But more recent example would be B.F. Skinner. Remember B.F. Skinner, the guy who did a lot of research into operant conditioning? A lot of the basics of how operant conditioning works were built using single subject research, mostly with rats or pigeons as the participants. So clearly, single subject research is still very useful, and I'm sure we're going to be seeing a lot of, you know, groundbreaking research in single subject design as we go into the future, but it's not going to be like the standard for most individuals doing research. Most individuals do like to compare groups instead of just tracking single individuals.